she goes.
It goes for the drop goal.
Good God. Too big and strong.
Sambo, 5 metres, 3 metres, over!
And Ashton is going! Ashton's going to score!
Oh, shut the gate!
And the stick in the field.
Comes out, and there's a chance in the corner. Oh!
Is it going to be a sensational score? It's going to... Oh, yes it is!
Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to a very special edition of the World Rugby Awards, which is, given that it's 2020, going to be a little bit different. As we near the end of what's been a very challenging year for society, for sport, and of course for the rugby family, we're going to pause briefly to pay tribute to some of the rugby players who have gone above and beyond in helping to combat the COVID-19 pandemic. And there are some truly inspirational stories to bring you over the course of this show. Then, very excitingly, we get to celebrate not just 1 year of stars, but the greatest from the past decade. In typical fashion, rugby has come up with a show-stopping finale to the year and to the decade. You, the fans, have been voting in your hundreds of thousands for your favourite players across six categories: the men's and the women's 15s players of the decade, the men's and the women's 7s players of the decade, and both the men's and the women's tries of the decade as well. Spoiler alert, we're going to be watching a lot of very good tries over the next hour or so, and also hearing from many of the winners. And while you've been busy, so have all of our World Rugby Awards panel, who have been put to work in choosing their 15-a-side team of the decade in both the men's and the women's format. No mean feat, and a fair amount of squabbling to get there. One of the legends on the panel is, of course, a World Cup winner, a Rugby Hall of Fame inductee, the one, the only, the fabulous Maggie Alfonsi, who's alongside for this, the show of the end of the decade for the World Rugby Awards. Maggie, how are you first and foremost? How has 2020 been for you?
I'm not doing too bad, actually. 2020 has been okay. I had a little baby called Artie. He's kept me up with lots of sleepless nights. But apart from that, all has been well. And it's been a pleasure to be on the panel trying to vote for the men's and women's team of the decade. That's been fairly entertaining and lots of debates, as you would imagine. But overall, it's been a good 2020.
You're looking very well, given you've got a little baby Artie alongside. Most people watching this will want to know at what point they can put £5 on Artie representing England, and how has it all been for you, you know, a journey into the unknown?
It's been interesting. You know, parenthood is definitely challenging, but at the same time, very rewarding. It's great to see Artie now finally smile back. But all has been okay. It's been a learning process. But yeah, I hope he gets to play for England. That's his destiny. He's going to be the England captain one day for sure. Right now, he's having to watch a lot of rugby games, whether he likes it or not. So I think he's picking up some tricks whilst he watches a lot of the TV.
That is very good to hear. And just a quick word as well. I mean, we know that you are very calm, very composed in your media duties nowadays. I just wonder how feisty and hot-headed it got being part of the panel and part of the selection process. Not just you, but we've got some fairly big characters in that selection committee as well.
Being part of the panel is great. Look, as you mentioned, there's lots of really big names on the panels for both the men's and the women's team of the decade, and lots of debates, but I think that's really important to have. You know, there's some players who have really stood out, there's players who have played for their country over a long period of time, who have really put in some big performances, and it's quite a long time to sort of have to decide who's been the standout players over that period. But no, it's been good to have those debates, and I think we've picked some very strong individuals in those positions, so I'd like to think that the public like it as well and agree with us.
Well, Maggie, we know that no one's going to agree with you. That's part of the game. Stand by. Tin hats on as part of a selection panel, and it is a selection panel. Let's take you through the dream team in itself. We've got multiple World Cup winners in there, Hall of Famers, and so many Test caps, it's fairly hard to add them all up. Alongside the great Maggie, we have got Sir Clive Woodward, Thierry Dussertoir, George Gregan, Richie McCaw, Fiona Coughlan, Brian O'Driscoll, Melody Robinson, John Smith, and that's just for the men's team. And then additionally, for the women's dream team, the likes of Lisa Burgess, Lynn Cantwell, Gail Mignot, Gillian Potter, your old teammate Danielle Waterman, and with an eye, I'm sure, from the media perspective, we've got Stephen Jones and Carl Tanana. It really is a who's who, And some of you, of course, couldn't vote for certain positions, Maggie, because you were nominees in them, though you certainly won't cast aspersions on your credentials and backhanders. We are bang up to date in terms of a really current and very knowledgeable panel. So all that to come, but first of all, as is tradition, let's hear from the chairman of World Rugby, Sir Bill Beaumont, who we caught up with a little bit earlier. Lovely to have you joining us at the start of our awards show, Sir Bill. First things first, we've touched already on the fact it's been an extraordinary year. How is everything with you? How have you survived it all?
It's been great over the last couple of months to have seen some games and been some outstanding international matches. I think the match that France against Ireland, and I think the first test Wallabies against the All Blacks, and then the Pumas beating the All Blacks in their first test since the World Cup, which was an outstanding achievement. But what I've been doing, I've actually been trying to lose a bit of weight. I've started exercising. Bought myself a bike. I bought a new bike. But actually, I do cheat a little bit because it's an electric bike. But it means that I don't run out of puff so easily. And I've lost over a stone in weight. So I feel quite pleased about that. So I've been exercising more, spending more time on Zoom calls. But just like everybody else, just hoping that eventually when we come out of this dark tunnel, then we'll be able to enjoy some rugby. And that's not necessarily only at the top level. What we have to do is get the game back into the community. That's really important because I do fear that there'll be generations of players who don't return to the game. So I think it's a real test for us in rugby to ensure that we get everybody back playing, because we know the benefits of being involved in such a team sport.
Absolutely. It's good to hear you've been out on the bike and you're looking very well on it. We certainly need the chairman of World Rugby to be firing on all cylinders when we do get back up and running. And as you've touched on already, there is a lot that I know you will have to be doing. But just quickly reflecting on this year, I mean, what have been the main challenges for you in 2020?
Well, I think the main challenges are obviously around the coronavirus, that it happened with such, it was immediate, that sort of Six Nations wasn't concluded, and then just really the unknown of when it was going to clear up, when we could start playing. We had lots of plans for different scenarios for when countries can get underway. And actually with New Zealand being the first country to come out of their lockdown, then I think that gave the whole rugby family something, some live sport to see. And then obviously Australia followed, and then the European countries as well. But also, let's not remember, there's been some outstanding club matches. You know, I think the Exeter doing the double is a great achievement for a club that's come a long, long way in a very short period of time.
So Bill, obviously, you know, we've seen some wonderful rugby on the field at the moment, particularly challenging to get these games underway, but we've seen some extraordinary acts off the field as well. And I just wonder, as chairman of World Rugby, how proud you are to see the individuals, some of whom we're going to recognise over the course of this show, but across the game, really lending their support to their communities.
I'm always proud of our sport, and I think out of this adversity and the pandemic, I think rugby's shown its true colours. Whether it's Jamie Roberts putting on his gown again and going back to be a doctor, or whether people at the local rugby clubs delivering food for old age pensioners, that this is something that makes me immensely proud to be involved in a game of rugby, and that keeps my enthusiasm for the game because of all the selfless tasks that people do for other people in our game.
And in terms of the to-do list, what's on it? How long is it? And, you know, what has got to come back quickly in 2021?
Well, I think we'd be looking at our season again. I think we've had the opportunity of being able to look at, did rugby work in the old days? Is there now an opportunity of rebooting it? And I think we got work underway there, looking at our seasons, whether we can optimise the calendar better. And I think there's lots of people working on that, whether it's with the unions, whether it's clubs, or whether it's league organisations. So I think there's a lot of positivity around there. We have a challenge with the Olympics coming up in Tokyo, so we've got to get those qualifiers out of the way. We've got to get the qualifiers done for the 21 Women's World Cup in New Zealand. So in a short period of time, if you think we're what now, sort of nearly December, that by the time sort of May comes round, then we're going to have all these things done. So it's going to be a hectic new year for everybody.
It certainly is. And we should, of course, say many, many congratulations on your re-election as chairman of World Rugby. What would your message be for the rugby family at this point as we turn out of what's been a very challenging year and turn into more challenges to come, but hopefully with fans back in stadiums and smiles back on faces?
My message would be that by working together, working collaboratively, we will ensure that we've got a better game for all the stakeholders, and that's what I will try and do, and that's what World Rugby is doing, that we will engage all our stakeholders so that they feel that they've got a part in the game, and whether it's from the players, whether it's from league organisations, then we have to ensure that we take people with us, and that's one thing that we will do. I'm pretty sure of it. But the message is that let's get back playing.
Good stuff. Keep peddling, literally and metaphorically. Lovely to chat, Sabil. Thank you for your time. And 2020 is certainly not going to be a year any of us are going to forget in a hurry. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Well, 2020 is certainly not a year that any of us are going to forget in a hurry. I think that's fair to say. And as Bill said, in the face of arguably the greatest global humanitarian challenge of our lifetime, the rugby family has certainly been playing its part. The lockdown has meant that we've seen a different side to some of our superstar players. Jan Uge, of course, giving cooking tutorials. Quay Cooper has been perfecting his trick shots, auditioning for the NFL, etc. And given that we've got the social media queen and hashtag influencer that is Maggie alongside, what's caught your eye over the course of lockdown on social?
There's been quite a lot of social media content, to be honest. It's been hard to keep up on it, really. But I think the thing that has really impressed me is seeing some of the England women, the Red Roses, do a lot of TikTok. I'm not really a massive TikTok fan. I'm still trying to get to know it, to be honest. But it's been great seeing them do lots of dance. Also, there's been the whole bottle cap challenge where they're trying to get the bottle cap off using a rugby ball. So it's been quite impressive seeing what people have produced over this lockdown period.
We've had so many highlights, of course, over the course of the last year, despite all those challenges. And since the world fell victim to the unprecedented effects of COVID, we've had countless examples in every continent of rugby players standing in defiant solidarity, doing all that they can to help. Let's have a little look.
Today, the greatest risk of global catastrophe doesn't look like this. Instead, it looks like this. If anything kills over 10 million people in the next few decades, it's most likely to be a highly infectious virus.
In the last few minutes, confirmation that the Six Nations match in Rome between England and Italy on March the 14th, along with the equivalent matches for the under-20s and the women's team, all postponed because of the coronavirus.
This is a threat to us. This is like nothing we've ever faced before.
We know that fear creates a prevention focus in individuals, and that means that they're going to start acting differently and look more for what could save their life and the lives of others.
Look, there's no easy way out of this.
But our priority is to save lives, right?
Of course it is.
And we have been lucky to catch up with some of the stars who have really been putting their back to the effort, starting with what has to be one of my absolute favourites, the man who 1 minute was in camp with Italy in the build-up to their Six Nations match with England, and only 5 weeks later had become one of Palmer's newest ambulance assistants, delivering patients in palliative care. It was genuinely quite a humbling experience to have a conversation with the great Maxime Mbanda. Have a listen to this.
Just tell us a little bit about how it all unfolded for you, because you would have been in Six Nations camp when it all really became very, very dramatic.
Yeah, it was really weird because one day you were training to play against a really good team in front of 80,000 people, and the day after you're alone at home with your family, and on the news there are notices about a virus that killed people, so the old people, the elder people are in really in dangerous. So I just try to help.
Tell me about your decision to volunteer. How did that come about?
I just wrote on Google, help coronavirus Parma. And I read an article that talked about a collaboration between the Commune of Parma and the Yellow Cross to help the old people, because they couldn't go out because of this coronavirus, but they still have to provide to food and drugs. So then I called the Yellow Cross, I went there. I start the first day with that services, but after the second day, because of there were not much people to go on the ambulance, they asked me if I could do it, and I did, of course. I was in the ambulance with the patient, with the person. So I've been a son, a cousin, a brother, because all of these people were older than me, and their parents, their familiar, their affective couldn't be with them. So I was just there to help them to not cry, to try to touch them, because they were really scared to go to die, because it was a very bad period. So I just tried to do my best, and I did it.
Wow. Tell me about a typical day.
I can tell you the first 6 weeks was so hard. I arrived at the Yellow Cross at 8 a.m. and then we were splitting in teams of two or three people, more often two, because of not so much people, and then we start. We wear all the suits, two masks, everything. We were really so dressed, so obviously to protect us. And before you were sanificated with the gas in a hospital zone, a positive hospital zone. You couldn't dress up, you couldn't go to the toilet, you couldn't eat, you couldn't drink. So the first 6 weeks was really hard. I arrived home after 12, 14 hours, because sometimes I had lunch at 6, 7 p.m. We just did it, we don't care about have lunch at 2 p.m. We just try to help to save more people as possible.
I know you haven't done this for recognition, and it's something that's sort of come as a byproduct, I imagine, but just tell me about some fairly significant recognition you have had, particularly from the president.
Yeah, I got the an award of Knight of the Italian Republic. That for me is, I think, one of the best things ever, even for my family and for Yellow Cross too. They appreciate it so much. But I think too that a lot of people in this period try to help. So I'm just chosen between a lot of people, more than 100,000 people. Everybody in this period try to collaborate, to cooperate, to help. So I started to play rugby because I like to share wins, to share feelings. So I want to share this award too.
People will learn so much about you from the actions that you've taken during COVID. I just wonder what you have learned about yourself.
I think not just me, but a lot of people, even in the lockdown, could have learned that there are a lot of things that we think they are so important, like the newer telephone, the best car, or the best dress. But at the end, where in this lockdown, we understood it, the best things are health, family, and love. So we just try to show in the future.
Well, that was Maxime Banda, a man who's put in a selfless act for the people within his community, and a big tick for the Back Row Union as well. An extraordinary call to arms, which was answered by Maxime. I mean, you've got to doff your cap to a man who is able to switch from mentally getting ready to play England to getting straight into action where it's perhaps more readily required.
Yeah, it's brilliant, you know, to think that rugby players like him go from, like you said, preparing for a big match against England to then next minute helping out his country and helping out his community during this awful pandemic. And it's great to see that he finally gets an award like that and to be recognised for the efforts that he's done. It's just pleasing to see. And, you know, there's many rugby players out there that have done some great stuff, but I'm just pleased to see that he's getting that recognition.
Great to see the Knight of the Republic back in action for Italy in the Autumn Nations Cup as well. So the circle has been complete, and you've certainly, as we said, got to salute Maxime Mbanda for his selfless acts in the community around Parma. And from one international on Italy's front line, we now hear from another who's been helping out in the land of his fathers. And unlike Maxime, of course, Jamie Roberts is actually also a doctor. 2020, hey, what a year. How are you first and foremost? What's happening? What's on your to-do list at the moment?
Oh, get ready for Christmas, get ready for the arrival of a little one in February. Our firstborn is coming in February. So yes, prepping the nursery, Alex, and trying to maintain life as a professional rugby player as well.
So obviously 2021 sounds like it's going to be very exciting, and we wish you all the very best with that. 2020 though, when you look back now, did you ever expect that all the studying you've done and the courses and obviously, you know, the qualifications that you've picked up would come in during your rugby career? Tell us a little bit about COVID, rugby, and what you've been up to in the midst of it all.
Obviously, the COVID pandemic struck mid-March, and it felt in South Africa like it was a few weeks behind the rest of the world. It felt like all this thing was unraveling everywhere, obviously in the Far East first, and then it came to Europe, started picking up in the US, and South Africa just felt as if it was carrying on as normal for a week or two. And then reality struck. The president of South Africa came on TV and said, look, we're locking down the country as of Thursday. So as a British national in South Africa, we did consider locking ourselves down in Camps Bay for a few weeks, but with a little bit of foresight, this thing was gonna last a bit longer than a few weeks. And you know, unfortunately, we made the decision to come back to the UK, which kept my time at the Stormers short. Came back, was in a bit of limbo for a bit, and just thought, you know, whilst not being able to train or play with any rugby, because rugby was cancelled across the globe, how can I put myself to best use? You know, I was sitting on a medical degree, and I knew, you know, there was going to be absolute chaos in the hospital. So unfortunately, I've been out of the game so long, I couldn't work clinically, which is the right thing, because I'm probably more of a risk than a help. And I ended up taking on a bit of a kind of communications role, and I just thought there was real power here in educating and kind of alleviating a lot of the fear out there.
You know, what did you learn as a result of your experiences?
Probably how quick people can adapt to change when there's enough pressure. When people's lives are at stake, changes can happen very quickly. And just seeing how people manage that change, the efficiencies within the hospital were amazing to witness firsthand, actually, and how they manage that change. They move mountains in weeks. What would have taken years to do, they did in weeks.
Was it a conscious sort of topic of conversation amongst the clubs and the teammates that you have gotten been a part of, that actually this wasn't just about, you know, hunkering down and protecting rugby, that this was actually a bigger issue for everybody to get involved in?
Yeah, without a doubt. And it comes down to community level as well. It's about helping the community. And certainly as rugby players, our jobs were pretty redundant for 6 months of 2020, albeit doing press-ups and sit-ups in your garden and running down the local field. So then it's about going, right, how can I best utilise my ability to help others in the community? You know, I found a way to do that in hospital. A lot of lads found a way to do that with helping vulnerable people in their communities. And that's great. And, you know, that is holding true the values of the game and the values of rugby. And that's why I love the sport. I think that's why a lot of people love the sport. You know, the values that sit behind the game. And it was great to see them, you know, come to the forefront in I suppose, desperate times.
So Alex, I'm really looking forward to hearing the next interview with Candace Pambuisa, who has been out there campaigning on two fronts with her emergency relief fund and also as a key voice in Canada's Black Lives Matter movement. So let's hear from her now.
For 5 years, I was, you know, envisioning going to the Olympics in 2020. And then, you know, no one anticipated a global pandemic. So it was like, now what? You know, like, what do you do from there? And it was kind of difficult because I was like, you know, obviously my goal is the Olympics, but there's so many people also that are going through it in the world and have their livelihoods like at risk. So I also worked at a hotel that became, well, it used to be a hotel and became a transitional housing for a lot of people that were unhoused. And from there, I saw that there were so many people that didn't have access to the government assisted services that were provided. So I reached out to Caroline Crossley, CL Arbor-Bome, Shaylee, as well as Percy, people within the community that I knew that were active. And so I was like, let's fundraise $15,000 to help support those that have access to a lot of government assisted programs, and also provide more of like an intersectional approach to aid that isn't necessarily standardized, but takes other things into account when providing that aid. A lot of what I do outside of rugby as well is I fundraise for scholarships and bursaries for the University of Victoria. And so I knew that I had that skill set to fundraise. So our team essentially worked towards, you know, finding creative ways that we can fundraise, whether it was a jersey auction, whether it was reaching out to different businesses that we can sell different products, whether it was asking every single friend I had on Instagram or on Facebook. It was literally anyone and everyone that I knew that believed in my journey knew that this pandemic is affecting everyone. And that was the first thing that I wanted to tap into, was the people who I knew invested in my development, but also understood that the development of others is also super important.
All of these things, you're working with people you work with every day and you support each other. And I guess that continues in life outside of rugby.
Honestly, like, my teammates are fantastic. I think it's just a testament of how the relationships that we've built from years now, that it transcends beyond the field. And that's what it's about. I feel like the biggest realization I realized from the Olympics not happening this year is that it's one event. The every single day, the practices, the hard sessions, that's what it's about.
And how much do you think have these last few months kind of changed you as a person and your outlook?
Tremendously, honestly. I think like these times have definitely affected pretty much everyone. I think, it made me really aware of my positionality and the responsibility that I was always so scared to have. And I feel like when, you know, I put on that jersey, I was always, you know, content with, like, I am representing Canada. And I was often scared to step outside that box. And I feel like once my reality was shaken, I realized that I can do more than just play. I can do more than just, you know, pass the ball backwards. I can speak, I can use my voice, and I can do something. And I think that was like the biggest realization, that I have support, I have people that believe in me. It's just a matter of me believing in me to make sure that, you know, I can propel my message forward.
And do you think the, like, kind of what you've learned will help you on the field as well as off the field?
Absolutely. I think rugby is such a, the skills that you cultivate in rugby is so transferable into every day. And that's that aspect that everybody's role is important. Whether you're a starter, whether you're an impact sub, you are a part of the team. And that translates onto society, is that how we choose to engage in this process is how much we are putting in effort to make society better. And I'd say, like, sometimes people may feel like, oh, like I can't do something, you know, I'm not the fastest player, or, you know, I may not have that best step. But it's like, listen, when you step on that field, whether you're on the sideline cheering your teammate, we're a team. And everybody has a position, everybody has a role, just a matter of tapping into it and believing that you can do something.
Well, well done, Canada's Pambuisa. That certainly is a lady on a mission. And Maggie, you've just got to stop and acknowledge that it's not just COVID in 2020. There are other very significant causes which rugby players have been supporting, and rightly so.
Yeah, look, it's great to see her, you know, use her influence, use her voice during what has been, you know, a difficult time, not just with the COVID, but like you said, there's been many movements during this lockdown period. And it's great to see players like that stand up and use their voice in a real positive way.
Well, finally, last but by no means least, it has been an absolute privilege and a pleasure to talk to the Rugby World Cup winning captain of last year, Sia Khaleesi, a man who's achieved extraordinary things on the field, but has been matching those off the field as well. He and a number of his fellow Springboks have been keeping hungry mouths fed in his homeland. And it's not just in rugby as well, Maggie. We should doff our caps to the likes of Marcus Rashford, who's made such an impact here in the UK. But focusing on Sia Khaleesi in particular, I mean, when you have a man who has led his country to the World Cup last year, doing such extraordinary things off the field this year, it can only inspire rugby players across the world to do their bit. I mean, how impressed have you been with his efforts?
It's absolutely blown me away. You know, like you've already highlighted, this is the Rugby World Cup captain in 2019, you know, who's very much well respected, who then goes and helps support people in his community, people in his country. I think, you know, we need to look up to people like that. They're role models, and it's great to see in the rugby world that there's individuals who are going out, making a difference, who are using, again, their platform, their influence to really inspire the next generation and be a positive role model for all, not just in rugby, but in other sports.
Good stuff. And I suppose as the game does begin to get whirring again, grassroots clubs across certainly the UK and Ireland and probably all around the world are going to need as much support as they can from those who can get involved and roll up their sleeves. So we'll look forward to seeing the heartbeat of the game grow stronger again as we move through COVID-19. But talking of heartbeat, none beat as loudly as that of the South African captain. And let's hear from Sia Khaleesi.
It's been a crazy year, coming up from such a high to doing nothing, basically, you know, not playing rugby, staying at home. But things are slowly starting getting back to normal.
You will have had a number of awards and you'll have had some very special nights over the last 12 months. But this is recognition for the work that you're doing away from the game. Can you just tell us a little bit about what you've set up, why you've set it up and how it's been going?
We actually, myself and my wife spoke about it the night before the World Cup. We were planning, when we win, what are we going to do? And then we started planning because we wanted to tackle a lot of the challenges that I face as a young kid. And yeah, we wrote some stuff down, giving back to the community, especially kids in school, making sure that kids get more than one meal a day at school. And then COVID hit while we were talking about the foundation this year. And then we were like, okay, we have to start doing something. Before the foundation was even started, we started speaking to our personal sponsors and people that we knew, and we got some donations, and we bought PPE for the essential workers. We sent some PPE to public clinics and public hospitals. And then the medical team said we actually need to keep people at home, which is the biggest thing, because people were going in the communities where I come from. People, like when I was young, I would go to my neighbors to ask for food and ask for a cup of rice or mealie meal for my grand to cook for me. So I knew that people will need to go around to ask for food, but during COVID, they had to stay at home. So then we started doing food parcels, and we joined with a couple of other foundations. And then, yeah, that's what we've been doing since then. And then we also doing things like gender-based violence and all those kind of things, making sure that we're giving those who don't have a voice and making sure that they heard, and also putting a man voice with gender-based violence, because I think there's not a lot of men talking about it.
Sia, it's remarkable. Yours is a remarkable story. Can you give us a little bit of insight into the impact that you've had so far? What are you seeing as you go about your work with the foundation?
It's been the tough part, because when the lockdown started, when it was level 5, we traveled about 16,000 kilometers up and down South Africa, donating to different provinces. And, you know, when I look at a lot of my past, I thought I struggled until I started traveling during COVID, where I went to places where people don't have water. They've never had water before. And that really broke me. And I knew that whatever I'm doing is not enough. This is something that I want to do after my rugby career. And I'm glad that I started it now. So it gives me more motivation to work even hard and not forget that, you know, without rugby, I wouldn't have had this opportunity. And that's why I'm so grateful. I think I'm always grateful for all my teammates and my coaches, and especially here at SA Rugby and my union as well, because without that success, I don't think I would have received the amount of support. So this is not only my hard work, my wife, and our team, but it's what we've done at the Springbok Rugby, because I'm not the only guy doing stuff. There's a lot of guys like Herschel, and there's a lot of guys, he even did some stuff in his communities as well. And some guys are quiet about it, you know. They don't like to talk about it. And we did something as a team as well, you know. We donated some more memorable clothing from the World Cup, five famous Speedo, Woolworths famous arm guard, and Coach Drassi's white shirt. And we gave that in to raise some money. And we worked with two organizations, I think Gift of the Givers and Food Forward SA, and donated, I think, over $1 million to them. And they donated food to the people in the communities as well.
See, it's an extraordinary story. 12 months on from lifting the World Cup, it's about the 15th most impressive thing about you. And you talk about being a good human being. I think that's pretty secure in its positioning.
Well, an absolute privilege and a pleasure to talk to the great Sia Khaleesi, a man matching his on-field actions with even more impressive ones off the field as well. And you've got to hand it to him, Maggie. He's laid down the gauntlet for others to pick up, match what he's doing within their communities.
Most definitely, you know, this is a guy who's the Rugby World Cup captain in 2019, wins the tournament, and then after that goes and helps out people within his community. I'd like to think what he has done has definitely inspired the next generation to want to do the same, not to just be a good rugby player, but to be a good person to help out those who need it.
But that is it as far as recognising those who have certainly contributed to the cause around the challenges of 2020. It is time to move on to the first of our awards and a quick reminder of what we still have to come. You, the fans, have been casting your votes for the first six awards and almost 500,000 votes have been cast. So it's a pretty big sample size. And once again from World Rugby, thank you to all of you who have got yourselves involved. The six awards are the Men's and Women's 15s Player of the Decade in association with Tudor, the Men's and Women's Sevens Player of the Decade in association with HSBC, and the International Rugby Players Men's and Women's Tries of the Decade. And then it's over to our panel for the final two awards, the Team of the Decade in association with MasterCard for both the men and the women. And that is from the dawn of 2010, which started, would you believe, with France's last Six Nations Grand Slam. And that goes all the way through to the end of Rugby World Cup 2019 last year, which of course took place in Japan. It's also worth pointing out that the nominees for all six fan votes were the winners of the World Rugby Awards in each of those respective categories. So some genuine greats in those lists, but it also goes without saying that there were some seriously good players not part of those fan votes, but they still may, of course, have been part of the panel's deliberations. Maggie, of course, being a classic example of that in the Team of the Decade. But first things first, we just want to check in. We know what's going to happen as soon as we post these to Twitter and Instagram. The social universe is going to explode. How civil, how calm a debating process was it amongst the panel itself, Maggie?
Alex, you've got rugby players and you've got coaches involved in that panel. It was not civilised. no, it was. It was. We debated heavily about players and coaches with regards to what we thought was the best. And it was really, really challenging. You know, we basically did a lot of Zoom calls. And it's quite hard when you've got people on the panel who are from the Northern Hemisphere and you've got people on the panel who are from the Southern Hemisphere, different times as well. So we all had to wake up at very awkward times to make sure we had these calls. And we debated highly with some key players in certain positions who we thought, oh, you know, are they the right ones? But I'm glad that we had that debate because it was important to do that. We want to make sure that the right players are put in those positions. And we've all got different opinions, naturally so. But I like to think that the team that we came up with for both the men's and the women's was the right one.
As far as the panel is concerned, Woodward, Stephen Jones, Grieg and Alfonsi, no naked flames around that lot, please. We will keep it civil as far as the awards show goes, certainly. And it is time for you to take out your notepad and pen and to jot down your contenders for the Team of the Decade and see how you match up with our panel when it's all revealed a little bit later on. Otherwise though, sit back and enjoy because it's now time for our first fan vote award. It's the Women's Sevens Player of the Decade in association with HSBC. And for this, we hand over to our esteemed panel member and smiley face to brighten any day. Ladies and gents, it's Danielle Waterman.
The nominees for the HSBC Women's Sevens Player of the Decade are
McAllister, beautifully done, cutting inside there.
McAllister. Gee, she's strong.
Last play of this half then. A lovely break. This is McAllister. Tremendous individual effort from Kylan McAllister.
Emily Cherry into the South African 22. All the way to the try line. That's a fantastic score.
That's quite brilliant.
Cherry right at the top of the charts.
Always dangerous, Portia Woodman.
She's done it again! She does it at the pace to get away second time. Woodman for the corner, Portia Woodman to win it for New Zealand!
She's electric, but more electric on the outside. Portia Woodman, yet again, scores for New Zealand.
Burn and turn and away she goes.
Charlotte Casley.
She's going to back herself to go the distance.
She's going to have to go on her own here. She breaks the tackle and off she goes.
Casley comes in with a physical, aggressive tackle. No, she just backs herself.
Casley kicks clear underneath the post.
Taylor Blythe.
Chopping back and field and spinning out of the tackle.
Look at those legs go.
This girl is manic. With a step in the field. She is good.
Chopping back in field, putting the foot down, ankle tap comes in. The speed of Michaela Blythe, what she got. Blythe hit the line again, skipping through tackles. Michaela Blythe, there is nothing she cannot do.
Now there's some space down the short side for Tui. Big fend in the face of Mark. Is Tui going to do it herself? Ruby Tui busting her gut to get to the line. And now Tui down the blind side, saw a bit of room and she'll scoot in herself. And Ruby Tui bags herself a five-pointer. And it's Ruby Tui.
Ruby Tui, some great defence in. Try time Tui.
Ruby Tui tries to back herself around the outside. Tui! Oh, almost at the line and then she's down!
And the winner is Portia Woodman.
Thank you, Nolly. One of my best mates, and many congratulations to Portia Woodman. What an unbelievable player she is. Now to our next award and another bunch of nominees, surely destined, COVID permitted, to grace the Olympic stage next year in Tokyo. From women's sevens to men's sevens, and the man on the poles is World Series commentator, former New Zealand sevens captain and panel member, Carl Tanana. Katie, over to you.
And the nominees for the HSBC Sevens Player of the Decade are...
It's Michaeli Pessimino. And away and gone, they'll not catch Pessimino.
Here's Pessimino, inside, outside, showing the class. Just too good in this instance.
Pessimino's clear.
But is Pessimino going to have the last word? Look at the pace of the man. He dives, he scores a hat-trick in the final.
Africa is going to go through. Beautifully done. Africa again, he's going to score it.
Cecil Africa, foot on the gas, over the 22. The chase is on, but he's got too much toe.
Tomasi Thama, this could be the clincher.
Thama is there, now it's a foot race. And Tomasi Thama opens the account for New Zealand.
Tremendous player of sevens.
Tomasi Thama. Step and put it down between the sticks.
Tim Mickelson.
Look at the support. That's so good of Tim Mickelson. And that gives New Zealand the lead.
He's around the ball. He often almost adopts the role of playmaker, but certainly starter and finisher of many, many moves.
He's got it away. Tim Mickelson, my word, what a man.
Samasoni, very, very.
You're not going to catch him.
Inside, outside, what a try.
He won't be stopped. Through the man that restarted and Colini Sao, Vidi Vidi. He continues to sparkle, this youngster.
He's a bundle of energy, isn't he? Werner Kock, what a brilliant individual score.
Kock is away. Werner Kock. Kock's got an opening. South Africa a chance to finish with a bang. And
Werner Kock, too big and strong. Has he got the pace? Yes, he has.
So alert, so electric. Out quickly it goes into the speedster. Siabelo Sinatla.
Hadold just looked up and gave it to the express pace and said, show us how quick you can go.
Super Sinatla.
Sinatra did it his way. Sinatla did it his.
This man, Justin Kanaki. Here he comes. The express driver. They won't catch him. Oh, shut the gate.
Baker looking to get on the outside here. Now, in fact, cuts inside. Baker gets clear. Baker, get the speed guns ready.
Here he goes. Perry Baker.
Baker, right off the bat, he's got rockets on his feet. He's off. He's gone.
Over to Baker. Baker comes back in field, beats Jones. Baker. Baker still going. Oh, no way. Is this really happening? Perry Baker.
Oh, Perry Baker. I mean, this darts move would clear an entire dance floor. Oh, that should be illegal. Perry Baker.
Going backwards. Baker left the ball behind him. Now wriggles away from the defence. And he clears out.
Baker's got a double. Two eye, look at the feet on the come though. He's a little magic man, in and away, still going.
Great cover defense from little Jerry Two Eye.
Two Eye for the line, he's over. King Jerry Two Eye.
Two Eye looks up and carries it away.
And the winner is Jerry Two Eye from Fiji.
I'm really happy, but I know I have lots of respect to the nominees, like Cecil and Tim Mickelson. These two guys really stood the test of time in rugby. And to all the nominees, like Rama, Perry Baker, Wanakox, Anatla, Samson Virviri, I respect them and I adore them. I love them as a rugby player and as a human being. I'm really happy to receive this award on behalf of them, of Fiji, my family, and on behalf of everyone who loves playing rugby.
Now to our next award, and these two are essentially just an excuse to watch about a dozen outrageous tries, and frankly, what else have you got to do right now but sit back and enjoy them? There ain't much better use of your time. First up, the International Rugby Players Women's 15s Try of the Decade. And to take us through this one, a member of the panel who is a Rugby World Cup winning Black Fern, a Black Fern captain, an officer of the New Zealand Order of Merit, and a police officer. What she says goes, that is for sure. Ladies and gents, it's Fee Farmer-Salili.
The nominees for the International Rugby Players Women's 15s Try of the Decade are
Stapleton on her own, just outside her own 22.
Play on,
says referee Barad. Chip over the top. The wide open space of the bounce is kind for Briggs, who'll have a go. Briggs the first tackle. Now then, where's the support? She gets it from Alison Miller. Miller the wide outside. Miller goes for the try line. It's a brilliant try for the Irish. And that is the try that takes the Emerald Green into the lead over the Black Ferns.
Oh, she's in difficulty there on the right-hand side of the French scrum, isn't she? France, well, they've coughed up possession there as a Canada look to bring it away through Marchak, looking for Harvey. Harvey's away over the 22, giving chases Mayones. Harvey inside Ledouf, launches away Magali Harvey. Can she go all the way in at the corner? Canada goal! What a fantastic try! Backs to the wall, right on their own try line. They stole the scrum.
This is Juliana Ree, the substitute. Ball for France again. Little chip over the defence. Good play for Wales. Oh, from number 14, Bethan Dinkin. We haven't seen much of her in this game. She's on for a charging run. She's still going. The tackle from behind comes from Lucille Gaudiver. Now Wales need good quality quick ball. They get it. Out to the right it goes. Slozil. It's moved up. Dudley Howell is up from fullback. The inside pass as well to Kira Bevan. They're almost up to the French 22. I haven't said that too often in the second half. Welsh ball, Wilkins. It's moved out to Harris. She's got two outside her. Great opportunity for Wales. The inside pass. Yes, going for the try line. Megan York. What a score. What a try from the Welsh girls.
Level of performance. The other dips. Scarrett. Water now. She's got some pace and some space to work it. Lovely work
from Waterman. Nolly Waterman. Is it going to be a sensational score at Twickenham? Oh, yes it is.
They use Woodman, who's changed wings, and now Woodman into the backfield. Pasha Woodman, you're killing me. That is magnificent. First rate care for the first rate athlete. And Pasha Woodman shows why she is so special.
And the winner is Pasha Woodman.
Yes, that try was pretty unreal. I think I just kept going until I got stopped, and I didn't stop until I was over the line, so it was pretty cool. Really special moment, yeah.
Talk about special. Here is the trophy for the try, voted by the fans. Now, we're not finished there. You also got voted as the Sevens player of the decade. I mean, that is huge for you. What does it mean?
Yeah, it's like I said before, the girls do so much work. We go through so many sacrifices throughout our lives. You know, playing the game for 9 years, you miss birthdays, you miss tangi, you miss seeing your whānau, but it's not necessarily a sacrifice for us, it's a choice because we want to be where we are and living the dream.
Well, there you go. Congratulations. To be voted in three categories, I mean, that is huge.
Yeah, it is. It was huge. And I was kind of joking to my partner. I was like, oh, what if I'm voted and I don't get any of them? That's pretty funny too. But no, it's an awesome, awesome result. I'm really privileged and honoured.
Now for the International Rugby Players Men's Try of the Decade. The mind boggles with so many to choose from, but we ended up with a sublime shortlist. And to take us through this one, another Rugby World Cup winning New Zealander who knows a good try when he sees one. Hello, Conrad Smith.
The nominees for the IRP Men's Try of the Decade are...
Genny awaits. He marshals everybody behind him. Sharp. His opposite number, Palmer, with another tackle. Australia, remember, a man down here. Genia goes himself, and Flood gets across, and it's Palmer once more. And that ball will come back on the England side. The man was turned, and Youngs is looking to go. Laws takes it on. Ashton on the outside. Ashton going up the wing. Takes on the fullback. Who was Mitchell covering? And Ashton is going. Ashton's going to score. It's England who made the statement.
And Guildford going at Adam Ashley Cooper again. This time Cooper not under as much pressure, but again, he can only make it just to 22 or beyond. And there's the kick from Genia straight up in the air, so they're not clearing it outside their own territory. And Pocock does well, snatched it away from Richie McCaw. Now it's Sabo, and Big Radicki throws a dummy, gets rid of one. Radicki, oh! Sabo, clear run to the line. Can he get away from them? Sabo, 5 metres, 3 metres, over! What a try!
And again, taken down. This time Pina on the back foot gives the pass off to Habana. Away goes the speedster, still going, and what a try!
Hang about.
Michalak gets it in, and taken off the best back by Nainga, swinging wide. Dag and All Blacks missing a couple of first off tackles, but it's worked out okay, and they may just get this. And it comes to Wepu, and Barrett moves it across. And here comes the attack from wide out. Ranger on the charge. Got a beautiful pass back to Conrad Smith. Now the chase is on, and the bounce of favouring Cruden looks to offload it beautifully done, and Barrett is away. What another great try.
In Smith again. Fekitoa dropping it onto the boot. Back goes Habana. So quickly onto him to make the tackle. Habana's done well to recycle this. LaRue from deep. And Pollard. And it's Serpentine for de Villiers. The chip kick through bounces well for Hendricks. And then Serpentine just couldn't get away from Aaron Smith. Here's Oakhart. Front floor in charge. He's going to go all the way. Sensational try.
Going high, taking taking it above the head, then taking off on his own. Para. Well, France, have they been reignited by that try? Fofana looking to work his way through a maze of bodies. Thales, nothing really on, so he kicks.
A panic kick. No structure. Now it's the New Zealand counter.
And Carter calmly puts it high. Ben Smith with the chase. And he's got it, Ben Smith. Spedding's gone down in a heap. Brilliant take. And now the French are in all sorts of trouble.
Turner just warned to stay onside. He goes up here, snaps it back. Been a strategy they use pretty well, and Jack McGrath comes away with it. Tackled by Garcia. Maybe one last throw for Ireland. Sexton again, the wraparound. Zeebo did well to hang on to that ball. Zeebo to get the hands away, and the offload was beautiful. We haven't seen that too much. Sexton with the dummy, and the pass to Trimble. Brilliant by Ireland. McFadden. Fergus McFadden, surely. Oh, he gives it to Heaslip. Heaslip for the line. Yes! Ireland are in again.
Argentina happy to play from deep through Alemano. And here's the other centre, Orlando. And outside him, Boffelli. Boffelli feeds to Colette, and Argentina's lead grows. Brilliant try, absolutely brilliant.
That's the 22.
Well done, Blake.
And Retallick was entitled to come through.
That's right.
According to the referee, and so a turnover. And now they'll look to make them pay on the far side. Barrett on the inside. Bowden Barrett. Maddox makes the tackle on halfway.
No fullback for the Wallabies.
Short side, Goodhue. And now Ben Smith evades one. So good on the counter-attack, the All Blacks. Corabetti in a bit of trouble on the far side, but it's now Anton Leonard Brown.
Wallabies down to 14 men. Folau has just left the field.
Quick hands. Here's Retallick. Throws the dummy.
To the final 2.5 minutes. It's Barrett again. Smith. Paranara bustling his way through beyond the 10-meter line. TJ Paranara sells the dummy. Someone gets the ball away as well. Bridge brought down by Klim. Lovely break from Paranara, but once more they're on the move. Ioane has got it away, and now into the corner goes Paranara, tiptoeing his way down the touchline.
The winner is Jamie Heaslip.
Jamie Heaslip, the scorer of the try of the decade. It's always nice to catch up. You've achieved a heck of a lot in your career. With Lions, with Ireland, with Leinster, and now you've got a little gong to pop on the mantelpiece. Is this one that you will raise aloft and take a lot of the glory for? Is this the one that you'll cut into 12 different pieces and pass it around those teammates who helped you get it?
Well, looking at it, there were 9 passes and I think 6 people touched it, and I was the only forward. So I'm going to take this on behalf of all forwards around the world, that we got on the end of something eventually. But it's funny. It's funny you say. Well, this is actually one I will put in the mantelpiece. I literally have one other award up in my office, besides my caps. I have my caps, and that's the only other rugby piece to have. And that's the award I got for contribution to the game, kind of off the field. And I like the way this is one that is very. This try is very much a team try. Like I said, 9 passes, 6 pairs of different players were involved in it. as well as players working off the ball. Keith Earls comes to mind, who he kind of gets taken out of it, running a hard line, getting the pass, and then Ferrier gets it. So thanks, Earlsy, for taking one for the team. But I love that it was the team try, especially when you looked at some of the tries that were up. There were some amazing, absolutely amazing tries, some unbelievable individual brilliance from players. But I think this try shows the values of what rugby and world rugby is about.
Jamie, lovely to catch up. Look after yourself, and I know we'll be seeing you sooner rather than later.
Thanks, mate, Alex. Take care.
Now the stakes raise even higher. Our 215's Players of the Decade in association with Tudor, and first of all, the Men's Award. And Maggie, I'm going to hand over to you for the nominees.
I'm so excited about our next award, and as a member of the panel, I get to present it. Let's be honest, it's an incredible list of players who have won World Rugby Men's Player of the Year over the past decade. And there are eight names because two men, Dan Carter and Beauden Barrett, got greedy and won it twice. Let's remind ourselves of who they all were.
And it comes to Jim McCaw bouncing his way past the first tackle.
Beal pulled out from behind by McCaw.
McCaw goes hunting. McCaw taking it to the line.
And he shrugs off a defender. And McCaw! Richie McCaw! Try to the All Blacks!
McDonough came in off his wing. McCaw! Richie McCaw!
Well, and truly nailed by Doucetois. Big tackle. Rosary Doucetois! Big tackle by Doucetois. Doucetois just a couple of metres away.
Through goes Carter so easily.
To right for the touchline, and he just doesn't look like missing. See the little flick from Carter.
The pressure from Ireland, there's 100 of them there.
It's another nice strike coming around.
Now here's Kieran Reid driving for the line, and they've got it down. Short pass to Reid.
Didn't rush that, played it beautifully. Here goes Reid. He's going to get another. Kieran Reid has shone brightly.
Another touch of genius.
Here's Kieran Reid again. Now Brody Retallick, what a season he's having.
Look at the big man go.
Pops it up. Brody Retallick.
Retallick
puts it on the ground. Youngs has knocked it away. Knocked it. Oh, here goes Retallick. Look at the pace.
Now some room for Carter.
Carter goes for the drop goal. Dan Carter, what a kick!
Barrett's after it. Will it set up? Oh, it does! Beauden Barrett, the man with the golden touch, scores another one, and the All Blacks lead by 22-16.
Close to Barrett. Beauden Barrett straight through. Absolutely brilliant.
Sexton waits. Here it comes. Looks good. He likes it. Nigel Owen's arm goes up. And Ireland have stolen the game.
And he has got it.
Sexton. Wonderful pass. And Stockdale finishes.
Once again, Sexton with the quick pass out to the near side.
The Wallabies will have to be careful with their discipline. The inside ball.
Etzebeth, the other second row. Mostert was the first. Peter Steph Dutoy scores for the Springboks.
Dutoy.
Steph Dutoy, and Salah.
Steve Everett has just been an excellent in defence throughout the game, flying off his line, making hits. Strength, rebound, Peter Steph Dutoy.
The voting was so tight on this one, it went right down to the wire. And I'm told four men led throughout the fan voting. But let's see who won. A massive congratulations to Richie McCaw, and our man Carlton Arnie caught up with him down in Christchurch.
Now just tell me, what's the first thing that pops into your head when you receive an award like this?
Well, I guess the first thing you think about is, there's a lot of great players that you got to play against alongside, so to be able to get an award like this, you know, is pretty humbling. And when you're in a team sport, it's always, you rely on a good bunch of teammates around you to have any sort of success. So I guess I was lucky with that. And you're probably quite lucky, I only played half the decade. So, just very humbled to receive an award and amongst some great players.
Well, to be fair, when you captain your country to back-to-back World Cup titles in the same decade, when you play the way that he played, and when you conduct yourself in the manner that he has done throughout the course of his career, I think it's fair to say that he is a deserving winner of the World Rugby Men's Player of the Decade. Well done to the great Richie McCaw. And now to our final fan award. To introduce our nominees, would you please welcome the one and the only, Mr. George Green.
The nominees for the Women's 15th Player of the Decade in association with Tudor are
the Hacker comes through! She comes crashing through! She's a try machine, isn't she? Poor Hepper goes round the outside, she fetches her chances, and so she should.
Looking to see where the opportunities might be. She is superb! Absolutely brilliant!
Hunt came in, out wide, on the far side, it's Michaela Staniford over the line. She's now scored an incredible number of tries. That's her fourth try this campaign.
Feeds on to Staniford. Staniford up to the line. Is she there? Yes, she is.
Intelligent from McAlee Harvey. It's rolling towards that touchline, but Harvey's managed to keep it in. And we've got our first try of the match.
And France, well, they've coughed up possession there as the Canada look to bring it away through Marchak, looking for Harvey. Harvey's away over the 22, giving chases Mayones. Harvey inside Ledouf, launches away Magali Harvey. Can she go all the way in at the corner?
Coxage, a little strike for us.
Coxage, the scrum half.
Coxage with the wide pass.
Tapped up by Coxage, it's advantage New Zealand.
Coxage
dashing across field.
Coxage. Lovely break from her, lovely feet as well. Hunter controlling. And Hunter is driving over and scores.
Hunter over the 22.
She likes to score a try or two.
They use Woodman, who's changed wings, and now Woodman! Woodman.
He's just in the right channel to make the tackle. They need numbers now. Tremelia to go all the way and win it for France.
What a kick from the fullback. What a start from France. Tremelia stretches out. Tremelia goes for glory. For the little pop pass to Emily Skerritt.
Skerritt! Skerritt! Harrison with the crossfield kick it. And we're going to go up for Skerritt! Oh! The thief of the night, Emily Skerritt.
And the winner is Jessie Tremulier.
Ouais, c'est le titre suprême, je pense qu'il n'y a pas un titre qui peut aller plus loin. Ça me fait rappeler toute ma carrière, mon début de jeunesse jusqu'à maintenant et tout ce que j'ai pu vivre au sein de mes clubs, avec mes partenaires, des mauvais moments comme des joies. Donc c'est vrai que ça remet des images dans la tête et ça fait plaisir de penser à tout ça. Et voilà, grâce à ce titre.
Maggie, let's keep it nice and simple between the two of us. I imagine it was fairly heated around the selection table at times, but what were you judging on? How hard was it? And who had the casting vote in all of this?
It was really hard, you know. We had to look at the amount of caps that a player had, the length of their career, performances over the last decade. And there's been a few players who really stood up and showed what they're capable of. So in terms of our panel all making that decision, it was really very hard. But I'm glad that we had those debates, we had those discussions, because there are also players where you almost would probably say they played part of the decade in that position and then they changed again, or they were really good as a combination of many other players. So there was quite a lot to talk about. But yeah, it was very hard. No one person had the casting vote. We had to make sure that we all had a bit of an agreement on certain players. But yeah, we managed to come up with what is a very good side for both the men and the women's.
I really do think World Rugby should issue tin hats to all members of their judging panel, because as we posted to social media, time to pop it on and prepare to take what's going to come your way. Let us reveal the World Rugby Women's Team of the Decade in association with MasterCard. Maggie, well done on making the selection for this team. Never in doubt. I don't think there was too much speculation about who'd wear that seven shirt in the team of the decade. I'm going to have a chat with you about what it means to receive this award in just a moment or two. But first of all, let's hear from two of your former England teammates also in the list. Emily Scarrett, who was a unanimous choice, and Danielle Waterman. Two of the golden girls of the women's team of the decade. Who is more golden out of the two of you? It's quite hard to pick, actually, at this point. Who'd like to put their hand up and be the more golden?
Nolly with that light on her head at the moment.
I was going to say more the blonde.
Very good.
I don't think anyone, Alex, will ever compare to the Emily Scarrett's goldenness.
That is very true. You are actually, and if we're going on selection, then Emily, you are the golden girl because you were the only unanimous choice in this 15. I think it's fair to say you've collected more awards than caps over the last 12 months, continuously in a dress at some sort of podium somewhere in the world. How has it been for you? What does this award mean to you, and how's the last 12 months been?
Yeah, it's been a bit of a whirlwind, hasn't it? Just not everything going on in the world for one, but the rugby world's been a bit crazy for me the last 12 months. Like you say, picking up a couple of awards, which you never expect. I think I said it on the night to you that you play a team sport, you don't expect to pick up individual accolades. So it's a bit strange, and you kind of feel like you probably cheated the other 14 girls out of it a bit. But it's super special to kind of be recognised in that way, and I guess again with this it's awesome, and to be put in a team with some of the names that are in that team is pretty cool.
It's crazy because what it's allowed me to do is just look back at the decade and see how far I came as a player, you know, the experience and the journey I went on, but more so just the game as a whole. And actually it kind of in my head kicks off in that World Cup back in 2010 in London, and then you kind of go through the following two World Cups and now the girls playing live on BBC and having nearly a million viewers, and you know, it's just absolutely amazing, and to be part of that journey and to have played a small part in changing how people perceive the women's game sounds really cheesy, but I think that's what's pretty cool for me about being part of that team, and also the fact that with that pack, I won't ever have to, or that back line, I won't ever have to make a tackle at fullback.
Well, it is a heck of a team, and congratulations to both of you for your selections. As we said, two of the golden girls. If only we could see you all in action, but Emily, that's over to you now. Good luck for the next 12 months or so. Nolly, we'll see you in 2030 for the next selection process. But well done to both of you. Lovely to chat, and keep up the great work. Well, great to see smiles on faces of two of the Red Roses, and Maggie, a smile for you as well. I don't think it was ever in doubt who was going to wear the 7 jersey in this player, this team of the decade, I should say. But for you personally, what does it mean to be recognised in this way?
It means so much, you know, to be alongside many other greats over the last 10 years was quite special. And look, there's many other players that probably could have played that number 7 jersey who unfortunately didn't make it in that team. So it's just nice to be in that squad, and I'm really very honoured, and it's just great to see the women's game come so far and to have so many players, you know, potentially could have made that team. It's a strong women's game, and it's getting stronger and stronger, I think, every year, and yeah, I'm just very honoured.
Well, you've obviously helped to build a bit of a legacy with England at the moment. We mentioned obviously you and Nolly and Emily Scarrett as well. You are 3 of the 8 English women represented in the team, also 6 New Zealanders, and we're going to hear from some of them a little bit later on. And by my maths, which has never been very strong, that leaves just one other player not from England or New Zealand in the team. And let's now hear from the lady picked at number 8, and that is France's Safi Ndai.
Ben, quand tu m'as énoncé la liste, c'est vrai que c'est une équipe exceptionnelle, magnifique. Voilà, c'est des joueuses contre qui la plupart j'ai eu la chance de jouer, qui sont des joueuses exceptionnelles. Donc c'est vraiment, je suis vraiment très honorée de pouvoir faire partie de cette équipe, d'autant plus que je suis la seule française et voilà, je suis assez chauvine et fière de représenter la France. Il y aurait eu beaucoup de joueuses qui auraient pu me remplacer, que ce soit en France ou dans d'autres pays. Mais voilà, très honorée et très heureuse de pouvoir représenter la France.
Here we are with the team of the decade, 5 in fact, from the Black Ferns. And well, ladies, firstly, the reaction for you to be named, Linda, in this team.
Oh, I had to actually look twice to make sure that they had the right name on their letter that was sent through, but it's absolutely privileged. And I know that there's plenty of other women out there that could have easily taken this position.
Fee, to have this number of Black Ferns in this team of the decade, what does that mean?
Oh, I'm extremely proud. I mean, we've built a lot of great legends in the Black Ferns, and I'm sure that there should probably be more girls up here, but I'm just extremely proud to be amongst all these girls and these Black Ferns.
Now, Kelly, you have to tell me, who's the character out of the squad? And don't be shy letting us know.
Probably to your far left, once upon a time.
Why?
Many reasons, but we won't say them today, but you know, there's probably still a few about. Mainly some of the young girls. Kendra sometimes pipes up, has a word or two to say, but I guess all the girls are quite characters in their own way.
Kendra, your reply?
It's actually Kelly. She's a silent assassin.
She's the funny one in the team. But now we've got a lot of girls who are very funny, and it's enjoyable about the team, and that's what makes you coming back, keep coming back.
And for you, Skip, just tell me, not so much the sacrifices, but what you have to do to be so good for this long.
I think that's what kind of makes this group so special, is that it's the legacy that's been built on from the past players, and we are trying to pave the way for the young girls coming through, and that was just a perfect example of it. We had all the young girls in here today here to support next year's World Cup, but for us it's what we can do now for the future.
We'll leave it on an absolutely inspirational, ladies. Congratulations on being voted into the Team of the Decade. Well done.
Okay, let's move on. Maggie, this is all yours.
Yeah, so what an honour for all 15 of us to be in the women's team, who will now be in the men's team. We stand before the final summit, the final push, the men's 15's Team of the Decade in association with MasterCard. Goodness me, there were so many players to consider for this, and serious battles in every position. Astounding quality throughout, but let's see who made the panel's final 15.
Just Sam Tank coming down. Oh dear. Oh, the beast is over! Away comes Bismarck Duplessis. Almost into the last quarter. The kick charged by Bismarck Duplessis, and he's got it!
It's Bismarck.
There is Owen Franks. He had a good day on the scrum front. Franks.
Now Owen Franks spinning in the tackle.
He had a big game tonight, did Owen Franks.
Now Brody Retallick, what a season he's having. Retallick,
look at the big man go.
Now the kick from Michelin is charged. Brody Retallick will score. Whitelock goes up and wins it. That is priceless. Sam Whitelock picked his moment.
Here's the steal from Whitelock. That's just incredible reading of the line-out.
Ball charge now. The All Blacks are after this one as well.
It's the Pocock show, isn't it?
Brilliant tackle.
He is so quick on the ball.
Pocock. Pocock. And Pocock. Here's the steal from Pocock. How good is he? The All Black captain steams down over halfway.
McCaw, wherever the ball is.
Release.
He's there.
Tackle McCaw.
Richie McCaw
and New Zealand.
Stay. Okay. Parise off a good scrum. Flips a nice ball back in field to Zanni.
Parise, very clever work.
Parise is on fire tonight.
Plenty of numbers to the right. Intercept by Parise.
He really is a world-class player, and he is the talisman for this team.
22 with Conor Murray, and a fine kick there with Parise waiting.
Still playing, Murray! Murray's got it!
Murray darts round the blind side.
Great vision from Conor Murray.
Carter goes for the drop goal. Dan Carter!
Here's Carter.
Drop kick from Carter. Now Carter. He's clear.
Now some room for Carter. Defend. Oh, brilliant ball to Salvia! Here's a banner. Diana Banner.
Havana. Bill Williams to Nonu now, and Nonu finds a way through, steps, oh Nonu, my God, score here, Nonu!
He's going to do it!
He's limp off the back to Conor Murray, here's O'Driscoll,
and now O'Driscoll down the left side, and inside ball, slices through, looks inside, and it's Brian O'Driscoll who scores the first try of the match.
Ben Smith with the chase, and he's got it, Ben Smith! Starts, Ben Smith giving chase, oh he's taking it, brilliant work from the All Black fullback, the way to Kane, Conrad Smith, Ben Smith, and in for the try!
wherever you're from, whoever you support, you have to say that is one heck of a team. One Australian, seven New Zealanders, three South Africans, two Irishmen, one Welshman and an Italian, and not a punchline in sight. I can hear Twitter spheres reaction. I can hear the humming going already. Stand by your beds and feel free to agree, to disagree. Let's play nicely, shall we? Maggie, so many to choose from. I would love to see that team in action. How much debate went into it and how did you reach the final selection?
Again, similar to the women's team in a decade, there were so many players in certain positions where you would go, well, I don't know if they would work really well in that unit, and are they actually the best player of the decade, considering some of them were really good at the start of the decade, where another player stood out at the end of the decade. But there were some really heated discussions. But I like to think, again, that the team that we've selected is a true reflection of what has been outstanding performances over the last 10 years. And it wasn't easy, but I think this is a good team.
OK, brilliant. Let's have a canter around the course and hear from some of the old warlords themselves. Some wonderful players. And first up, Habana and O'Driscoll.
I can't believe Richie McCaw managed to make that team. It's kind of flabbergasting, isn't it? Like, literally, there's a few guys that just pick themselves. Players that stand out for me is the impact that kind of Beast had at the end of the last decade in the Lions Tour for South Africa in winning that series. And then at the end of the next decade is winning the Rugby World Cup with South Africa. And that consistency of performance in a country where there's no shortage of loose head props, to be able to consistently stay the pace and fend off, possible adversaries is pretty impressive in an attritional position like that. So I guess it's those guys for me really stand out that have been able to consistently do it for 10 years.
Someone for me that really stands out is Sergio Parisi. I think the talisman of the Italian team, a guy whose team, I think have lost 100 games in a row in comparison to Richie McCaw, captain New Zealand to 100 wins, and to then be playing at such a level over such a long period of time, to be recognised by peers and fans around the world as someone who was just so world-class in a team that always struggled, I think is really exceptional.
Well, it's certainly one hell of a back row. If you're looking at combinations, you're not going to get a little change out of McCaw, Pocock and Parise. And first of all, let's hear from the great Australian, David Pocock.
So many amazing experiences in rugby, and feel very grateful for the opportunities I've had. Moved to Australia as a 14-year-old, and it had been my dream to play at a Rugby World Cup since I can remember, and to go on and play for the Wallabies and represent Australia and represent so many people back in Zimbabwe at three World Cups has been a childhood dream. So feel incredibly lucky to have had the career I did.
And let's hear as well from Italy's talisman over the last 10 years or so, Sergio Parise.
Well, I never expect something like that. Obviously, it's a huge honor, I humbly thank you, World Rugby, for this award. Of course, it's a really nice thing for my career. I arrived at the end, of course, my career, and the last 10 years were really excited for me. Exciting in terms of rugby. I hope to. To play my best rugby in the last 10 years with the national team, with my club, Stade Français, with my new club, Toulon now, and it's really nice to be involved in this team. When I saw maybe the other guys involved and the other number eights who play in the last 10 years, that means a lot for me, and especially because I was involved in a national team that we don't get too many victories during the way, be in those 15, it does mean a lot, and hope does encourage as well that the Italian rugby players to keep working, follow your dreams, and I think rugby is about that. And I personally never was really a fan of awards and personal achievement. I think is rugby is about group, but I'm really proud of course of this award.
And fittingly, perhaps, let's finish with two good mates, two good teammates as well. They had a pretty good decade. In fact, they weren't bad the decade before that either. First of all, the World Men's Player of the Decade, Richie McCaw.
It's a pretty cool list to be alongside, eh? And each one of them have done some amazing things for their teams. I was lucky to play alongside a few of those guys, and having people like that alongside you makes playing rugby pretty easy. And yeah, my old mate DC, we got to play a long time with him, and he must have been close to winning it perhaps, because he had a pretty good period too. But it's pretty cool to be alongside them.
And the man who played alongside him, not only for the All Blacks, but the Crusaders as well, Mr. Dan Carter.
It's a huge honour. It's probably quite a couple of number 10s that could have easily slipped in there ahead of me. So extremely grateful that that I got part of Team of the Decade alongside some rugby greats. So yeah, it's a huge honour.
Talk about rugby greats. One of them is your best mate, Richie McCaw, and he actually got the Player of the Decade. I mean, for you seeing him receive that award, that must be awesome.
Yeah, it's great. I often look back on my career, our career, and often realise how lucky I was to be playing at the same time, the same era as Richie McCaw. He was a very unique, special, once in a generation type of player. So, it's not strange that he won the Player of the Decade, absolute champion of a man, and such an amazing rugby player.
Once again, congratulations.
Thanks, mate.
Well, as awards do's go, this one has had its fair amount of stardust, pretty much from start to finish. Be honest, how many of you picked that 15 in both the women's and the men's? If you did, I'm told there is a place awaiting you in 2030 for the next decade reflection. Send us an email and we'll get you booked in for that. Maggie, I'm sure you'll be there as well. It's been a lot of fun and it's lovely to ride in your sidecar as always in this kind of thing. A quick reflection, quite nice to have it done and dusted after a lot of not only analysis, but debate. How good to have this locked in and some pretty strong selections as well.
You know, it's a huge weight off my shoulders now. It's quite nice to see it finally out there. But it's great to see some of those big top players be recognised and lots of good awards be given to some good players who've had a fantastic decade. Yeah, I'm just pleased it's now out there and now I can enjoy the rest of my 2020.
We're almost at Christmas, which means we're almost at New Year as well. What would you love to see on the New Year's resolutions for Rugby Union after a pretty horrible year? We've reflected on a wonderful decade. Here's hoping we've got 10 very exciting years to come. But, we need to get fans back in stadiums, smiles back on faces, and get these competitions back to where we know they should be.
Alex, you really highlighted it. What I want to see for the next decade, starting in 2021, is fans in stadiums. Next year's we've got a lot of rugby in store with the Women's Rugby World Cup in New Zealand, and obviously the Lions Tour in South Africa. I want to see fans out there watching the sport, especially in the Northern Hemisphere anyway, and just really getting back to what we love, and that's rugby.
Same time, same place, 2030, by which time Artie will be a member of England's under-10s. And I'll be a little bit greyer, and you probably won't have aged another day. I don't know how you do it. Maggie, lovely to hang out alongside with you. Thank you so much for your thoughts and your impact, and many congratulations on your due recognition as well. What a wonderful way to wrap up this very special edition of the World Rugby Awards of the Decade. As the curtain falls on what has been an extremely challenging 2020, we do have so much to look forward to in 2021. A golden year for women's rugby with the Olympics and Rugby World Cup 2021 in quick succession. We've got the return of the HSBC World Rugby 7 Series. We've got Rugby World Cup 2023 qualification. And of course, we've got the British and Irish Lions Tour to South Africa. Here's hoping it's a good one. Maggie, it's been a privilege to ride alongside you. Any final thoughts?
Only final thought I want to say is thank you very much, Alex. You've been a pleasure to work alongside you. You're a brilliant MC. And like I said, I am looking forward to getting 2020 over and done with and starting a new decade with what we have in store, with lots of good rugby. And just looking forward to Christmas now.
And so say all of us. Have a very special one. Lovely to catch up as always. Ladies and gents, that is it. Rugby is back. We hope it'll be better, stronger and even more exciting than ever before. Until then, it's goodbye from us. Look after yourselves and stay safe. Bye-bye.
I don't understand your question.
Mate. Oh, no.
Awesome result. I'm really privileged and honoured.
They're huge like your arms. Look at them.
Can you not?
It looks like we're interviewing her in witness protection. It is what I prepared earlier.
You have to remind me, this decade.
You talk about DC Dan Carter. He actually thinks he should get the watch and this award.
Give it to him.
Wow, it depends who plays his cards right, eh?
Gaz.
Always age before beauty.
Is that too high? Do you want me a bit lower?
A little bit.
I'm gonna re-record that. That's important.
Kendra K. Deep Porsche.
Sounds like the Kardashians. Bloody doorbell. Sorry, one second. Okay. We could actually do it. I'll put you properly at relax.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Speak to you soon. Bye, 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 bye.
Cheers, my mate.
Even though we're going to go with these things. I like that, bro.